And welcome back to Let's Play Mass Effect 3 Blind. I'm the RPG chick. We are going to be doing this time the... what they call it here? Priority Eden Prime. Which, I had a real-life friend tell me that this mission is actually the From Ashes DLC. So, other than that, it's cool to know I'm playing one of the DLCs, and I didn't even realize the whole Omega thing with Aria is a DLC as well. So, we're getting through DLCs. There aren't as many DLCs as the second. Definitely more than the first game. But from what I understand, the DLCs are a lot more meatier. There's no... I mean, there's really... most of them are... of a good length. More so than I think the second game was only really two. That would have been a long length, with being the Lair of the Shadow Broker and the Arrival DLC. At least I can remember. Maybe one more, but there were a couple DLCs that were in the second game that were just based on, you know, squad members and was really just an hour and a half, something like that. So anyway, we're getting into... I'm thinking this, but this is on Tuchanka, so you might as well do all this Tuchanka stuff at once. And even this, the Bar Levan, that's in the Krogan DMZ nebula cluster, what have you. So yeah, Tuchanka. And this stuff, we don't know where it is. Don't know where that is. Waiting for the engineers to finish. So this should update to say that they were working on it, but it has not. And heating unit stabilizers somewhere in the galaxy, like the improved power grid. And I don't know where Arun is. We might have to unlock that system, unless it's in the system we haven't been to yet. So yeah, let's do Eden Prime. Cerberus has discovered a Prothean artifact on Eden Prime. Land on a planet to recover the artifact. Relieve them of their artifact. Bloop. Alright. Exodus cluster. Engage. Okay, we got a couple. Ooh. There's something right there.
Signal confirmed.
Cool. What is this? Just found 200 units of fuel. Unfortunately, we're already full, aren't we? So we got two systems, including this one. Where's the other one? Asgard is this way? How far away? Alright, let's look at these planets first. If we can go to Asgard, just crossing the what do you call it? The Rainbow Bridge into Asgard. That'd be cool. But we'll check out these planets first. We got Arcadia. An unusually large terrestrial world, Arcadia has a dense atmosphere composed of nitrogen and helium. Its scorching hot surface is mainly composed of alkaline basalts, but metal deposits are plentiful. Although several spectacular examples of columnar, I think I said that right, basalt formation offers scenic beauty, Arcadia's hostile environment has precluded commercial development. Ooh, it's heavy. 5Gs on that planet. In Prime, we will go to last. Zion. Zion's where the party is. Matrix reference. First movie. I am a Matrix fan of the first movie, although there were some good, decent parts in the third one. Second one I was not fond of at all, really. I mean, it did have its moments, but they were few and far between. Anyway, I digress. Zion is a hydrogen-helium gas giant even larger than Jupiter. Despite its deep gravity well and lethal radiation, it supports a small helium-3 mining industry. The reason is simple. As the only gas giant in the Utopia system, it is the only local source of fuel for Eden Prime's power stations and spaceports. Zion has 112 natural satellites, ranging from orbiting asteroids to the moon of Asphodel, which is large enough to retain a thick atmosphere. Population is 1,062, pre-invasion estimates. On the moons, naturally. We have Nirvana. Smells like. Nirvana has a trace atmosphere of xenon and krypton. The surface is a mix of water, ice, and iron oxides with cryovolcanic plumes of potassium, concentrated around the equatorial ridge. Nirvana has little of commercial or scientific interest. Sorry, Kurt. Though a few... Actually, he was not interested in commercial anything in return either. So, though a few geological research stations were constructed in the early 2160s, all have been shut down for years. The Alliance maintained an automated ice cracking station, which stockpiled a large amount of deuterium fuel for use by the fleet. This was commandeered in the preparations for the war, and now Nirvana is completely silent. How sad. Last planet, Xanadu. I like these names. Xanadu's atmosphere is composed of methane and argon, while the planet's frozen surface is largely potassium with deposits of calcium. Its location in a deep cold of the outer system and the lack of valuable resources leave little to recommend it. Stuff. Alright, well, I can scan all three planets probably from here. Nothing. And we are not being alerted, or we are not alerting Reapers. Although they are in this system. I guess they're in the far away, you know, whatever, the Asgard system. Here we go. Zion. Alright, scanner. Probe away. We got Prothean data files. Nice. And we found all the assets for this system. Now, there's no fuel, but we are full. Well, we'll go down to about 500 and then all the way over here. Oh, this is a dirty trick, isn't it? We will make it back, though. Barely, but yes. We got three planets. No, four. Sorry, Terra Nova. Terra Nova was one of the Class 1 colonization prospects discovered by the first wave of Alliance surveys in 2150. It was the second human extrasolar colony and the first beyond the Charon mass relay. It once boasted the highest population of any formally endorsed Alliance colony, but in recent years threats of Batarian attack caused many to emigrate. The name Exodus Cluster became all too apt. The Reapers landed on Terra Nova after a brief battle with the Alliance's 6th Fleet. Aware that it would lose, the fleet retreated in hopes of meeting with allies and retaking the planet. Intelligence indicates that the Reaper force here is light, and debate rages over whether to try to liberate the planet or if such an effort would prove futile if the Reapers sent reinforcements. Population 4,150,000. Pre-invasion, of course. Colony founded in 2152, and the capital is Scott. Interesting name. Second planet? Bor. Bor is a hydrogen helium gas giant with over 90 moons. I think I've said hydrogen helium gas giant in this, well, all three games quite a lot. Every time I say it, it just rolls off my tongue. I've said it so much. The light of ionized hydrogen filtering through an upper cloud deck of sodium causes its striking coloration. The source of the ionization has not yet been confirmed, but Bor's mass, equal to 6 Jupiters, and high temperature suggest it may be a brown dwarf, a gas giant that gained almost enough mass to ignite into a small star. The Reapers destroyed Bor's extensive Helium-3 infrastructure, though wreckage indicates that the 6th Fleet did not give up the planet without a fight. Third planet, Tyr. Tyr is compositionally similar to Earth. However, it lies over 4 AU from Asgard and possesses an atmosphere primarily composed of nitrogen and ethane. While a potential target for terraforming, the proximity of the shirt sleeves habitable Terra Nova relegated Tyr to a support role. Nearly 100 corporations, human and alien, constructed tele-operated mining, refining, and manufacturing facilities across the planet. The Reapers immediately targeted these, seeking to cut off the Alliance's source of hydrogen fuel cells. Colony founded in 2156, population 44,000. Pre-invasion, of course. Capital's Caldedalar. How do you say that? And the last planet. Loki. Hold on a second, guys. A small terrestrial world with little to recommend it, Loki's one hemisphere is largely covered by ice and the other by craggy basaltic highlands. The rough, varied terrain suggests an ancient cataclysm caused significant damage to the planet. Reaching 6.5 AU at the perigee, and 7.1 AU at apogee, Loki's unusual elliptical orbit reinforces this hypothesis. Beneath Loki's ice cap runs a naturally formed network of subterranean tunnels. These may have proven useful to Alliance forces in retreat. Nevertheless, any organics hidden here remain in peril, as Loki's atmosphere is inhospitable and Reaper scanning technology is efficient. And just fly around looking for something. Waiting for that sound. That sound. But when I'm not running into anything. It's so funny because it's right there.
I found something.
Oh my god. Well, we found two things. Is that why they're so alerted? Because we did one scan and found two things? That's not fair. It's so funny because pretty sure it was in the second game. Yeah, we would fly around and we would hear that noise sometimes. Even though, I mean, you could only scan when there's on a planet. But it's like they played up on that. Every once in a while you'd hear a random boop, even though there was nothing there. And I'd go over that same area and you hear boop. Now it actually means something. It's interesting. 250 units of fuel. Good, to go back. Although we can make it. So pretty standard, you know, you find one thing of fuel and one planet to scan. Gotcha. Probe launched. I have found something. Alliance Naval Exploration Flotilla. ...40% assets recovered. Ooh. There's a lot of assets here. We're gonna have to come back. I'm gonna scan this planet. Can they get me now? This is gonna be a little hairy. Alliance cruiser Shanghai. Cool. Now we're gonna have to head. I know it doesn't make sense in space, but I don't know how else to say it. Downward, spinward, or whatever the hell. And I'm gesturing wildly, you can't see. That would be like southwest.
Evasion successful.
Good. 60%. Which means, yeah, we have two more things to find. We're gonna have to come back here after this mission. Just want to fuel up first. I could have gone in more of a straight line, but okay, whatever. We're alright. Eden Prime. This idyllic agrarian world was one of the first human colonies established beyond the Charon Mass Relay. Eden Prime's fertile biosphere drew heavy immigration from the Systems Alliance and other human organizations. In 2183, Eden Prime was attacked by a Geth force led by the rogue Spectre Saren Artarius. Commander Shepard, responding to the attack, encountered a Prothean beacon that warned of imminent Reaper invasion. It is thanks to this beacon, and the Commander's quick action, that the galaxy has any chance of survival today. Although the Reapers rushed past much of the Exodus cluster in their plan to take Earth, it is clear the war has come to Eden Prime. Distress signals have jammed all available frequencies, fires burn in vast swaths across the arable land, and its once extensive monorail system is twisted metal. Cerberus has much to lose if word of their ruthless attack on the human colony gets out. What they stand to gain must be equally valuable. Colony founded in 2152, population is 4.2 million, of course, pre-invasion. Capital is called Constant? What kind of name is that? Gravity is just slightly higher than that of Earth, 23 Celsius. Not that cold. Atmospheric pressure. A little heavier than that of Earth. Day length. Days are very long. 64 hours. Orbiting period is 2.5 Earth year. Seasons are longer. Anyway, land. Liara's already selected. Interesting. I mean, I don't mind. I'd probably bring her anyway. Let's bring Garrus, since we're coming back to Eden Prime. I mean, I know Garrus wasn't around at that time. But we're really... I mean, at the time that we went there. Slightly after. On the Citadel we found him. As you probably remember. But really, this is like a return, and Liara wasn't around either, of course. This is a return to, yeah, the beginning. It's like we've come full circle here. Back to Eden Prime, really barely any mention of it. We did come across the planet, I'm pretty sure, in Mass Effect 2, but you couldn't land there or do anything. You'd probably scan the planet, something like that. But, yeah, no missions there or anything. So yeah, Garrus and Liara. Going down to Eden Prime. You guys can see what it's like. Sure you heard so much about it. Gonna keep all the weapons the same. Can we... Let me see if we can modify. This increases accuracy. Penetration. Liara penetration. Okay, never mind. I didn't say that out loud. Heat sink. High caliber barrel. Increases damage. Let's increase her damage. I mean, is she really, as far as in the game, less accurate? These things don't, I mean, they might, but they don't necessarily, I'm not going to assume they work the same as with squad mates as they were, you know, with me controlling it, you know? Like, I know, for example, they have unlimited ammo. They don't run out of ammo. At least they didn't in the second game, so I'm going to assume it's the same here. So I'm not going to give them, you know, less, you know, an ammo extending thing. So, but increasing damage, I'd say, would work. Hits, you know, destroys the enemy quicker. Good thing. And there's no note about weight anything, so I don't think the weight even counts. So we don't need that, which gives you rounds. This helps you with rounds. So, yeah, just in case it counts, we'll increase her accuracy and damage. And here... yeah, I have magazine capacity. Let's take that out. Increases accuracy. Damage. Damage. Right. So this increases weight, but I don't think that matters for the squad members. Increase damage by 35%. There's no change here in her weight, at least that we can see. So I'm gonna assume all is good. If she starts sucking, then we're gonna know. Okay, so... Garrus has got sniper rifle and assault rifle. So I want something with fire rate, I'm sure. Capacity, you know what? Since weight and amount of shots fired doesn't really, at least I don't think, doesn't matter for a squad member, I'm only going to look at these three. I'm not even sure how much accuracy counts, because they're controlled by, you know, an AI. They're not an AI, but they're controlled by the, you know, the game. Fire rate, damage, accuracy. Highest damage is actually the Valkyrie, or Valkyrie, however you say. He's got no mods on here, so let's... Weapon stability. Magazine upgrade. No. I mean, maybe they have to reload more often, that kind of thing. Piercing. Increased damage, we'll do that. Ignore 60%. Wait, slot occupied. Oh. Wait, that's extended barrel one. High velocity barrel, okay. Yeah, this will really help against armored. And, yeah. Against armor. So we'll have them use that. Sniper rifles. I hardly ever use them. Out of any weapon in the game, this is really... I mean, first two games I couldn't even use a sniper rifle with my class. Now I can and I use it very seldomly. Sniper rifle concentration. Don't need that. Increase damage, that's good. That's good too. Accuracy. We'll take that. Okay. Sorry guys, so much deliberating. Okay, so I have flare now. Charge speed. Can't take the next. Damage and force or impact radiation. Recharge speed. Force damage and impact ratio of combo detonation. Impact radius. Damage for shields and barriers. Looks good. Who knows? I might replace it. I think in the med bay I can get my points back for that. I'm not sure. I'm pretty sure I don't get the money back. I think I wasted... I don't know. I wasted 5,000 or 10,000 altogether. Yeah, that was great. I should have gone back and reset, but I felt like, you know, going back to a previous save, but I felt like that would have been cheating against it, so... Live and learn. Can I take another proximity mine with him? Yes. Increases the recharge speed. And Liara? Can I increase her pure biotic? Yes. Weapon damage or power and power force and duration. Power force and duration. These singularities are going to be banging now. Done. Sorry guys, almost done with episode 1.
Eden Prime. This is where it all began.
That's right.
Where the Prothean beacon gave you the vision that warned us about the Reapers.
And where Saren launched his first major attack with the Geth.
That's right.
And now, with Cerberus here, Eden Prime's colonists are under attack again.
I remember Eden Prime, of course. Feels like another life. Wait, it actually was another life.
Seems like more than just 3 years ago.
Yeah, really.
I remember the reports. I was busting my ass trying to find evidence against Saren. Hearing that he'd attacked a colony while I sat mired in bureaucracy, that was a bad day.
This kind of seems like the renegade option, and this would be on the tip of my tongue, the Paragon option. Saying it got better. Well, I guess that's a sarcastic, it got better. Because everything went downhill from there. I'm thinking this is a sarcastic option, so I'm not going to pick it. You and bureaucracy doesn't sound much better. I guess that he doesn't like bureaucracy, so... Yeah.
You always did prefer a straight-up fight.
Right.
And you're always good at helping me find them.
Cerberus hit Eden Prime hard. Whatever they found here was worth a major offensive. There are survivors elsewhere on the colony, but... they killed everyone near the dig site.
Yeah, these people have it rough. If I were them, I would move. I probably would have already moved far away from this system as I can.
They deserve better. I know. The Alliance did what it could to evacuate colonists, but Cerberus came in so quickly.
If we find survivors, we'll do what we can. What about this artifact? Any idea whether it's part of the Crucible?
The Alliance didn't get any specifics about what Cerberus has uncovered. Since the original dig site here contained a warning about the Reapers, it could be connected to the Crucible.
I'm bringing you in as close to the dig site as I can. No way we'll avoid detection, but you should have a few minutes.
Okay.
Understood. All right, everyone. Get ready to move.
With luck, we can get to the dig site before Cerberus knows we're here.
Doubt it. Wait. I thought we were jumping all the way from up there. I was like, wait.
No sign of survivors. Come on, we need to find the dig site.
This was a beautiful colony once.
It survived, Saren. It can survive this.
I grew up on ships. Lose one, you can always move to another.
But you'd still remember.
We've got some secondary codex. From Ashes, yeah. Bonus codex entries, okay. Two, I'm just gonna read them really quick to, you know, refamiliarize ourselves with the whole Eden Prime thing. In 2151, as the first anxious settlers made their way through the new Charon Mass Relay, many of them wondered whether the reality of life on Eden Prime could possibly live up to the stories of pristine landscapes that drew them there. What the colonists found exceeded their expectations. The stable climate and compatible biology made the colony almost instantly viable. Over the next few decades, several million humans immigrated to Eden Prime and a primarily agrarian culture developed. The new colony quickly became not only self-sufficient, but began exporting goods. Chief amongst these were rare plants grown from Earth's many heritage seed libraries. But in 2183, the colonists faced a true test of their character. Eden Prime was attacked by the rogue specter Saren Artarius and his Geth allies. Not long after, the Citadel was attacked by those same forces in Eden Prime's neighboring world Terra Nova, found itself threatened with complete destruction. Faced with such violence, a lesser citizenry might have retreated back to the safety of Earth, as so many colonists of Terra Nova did. But Eden Prime's governing body refused to give in. Not only did the colonists vote overwhelmingly to block a measure calling for the building of evacuation ships, they voted to ease restrictions on immigrants from Terra Nova looking for a new home. As a result, Eden Prime's population has swelled. Whatever the war might bring, its status as a symbol of humanity's future in the stars remains unblemished. You gotta be really brave to live here and probably regretting it now. Technology, Prothean Beacon. In 2183, human scientists uncovered a Prothean technological artifact on the planet of Eden Prime. While repelling an attack by Saren Artarius's Geth allies, Commander Shepard's squad came into the artifact's proximity and set it off. The object, described as a beacon, sent the commander jumbled sounds and images intended to warn of the imminent Reaper invasion. The beacon overloaded during the process and violently exploded. Yeah, it was interesting. While the vision it provided was dismissed by the Citadel Council as a highly subjective experience, great. Since that time, the Council's Committee on Paleotechnology have analyzed the fragments of the beacon in an effort to understand how it communicated. What they found was not quite the telepathic technology that the Alliance Marines described in their reports. Really. The beacon was equipped with a mass effect field generator to hold its subject immobile, a necessary step to minimize collateral damage during the rest of the process. That's interesting. The beacon then nearly instantaneously scanned the structure of its target's optic and auditory nerves, as well as many parts of the brain responsible for memory. Once its expert system determined the proportions of these key features, the beacon stimulated them with pinpoint electromagnetic and other irradiative energy using powerful programs to recreate any images or sound the beacon required. In principle, this was similar to a popular entertainment device known as a SimStim, but vastly more comprehensive. SimStims directed the senses, not memory. The Normandy's medical officer noted that the beacon delivered more information over the space of seconds than a SimStim could do in hours, and managed to do so to a species whose physiology was completely unknown to its designers. To a paleotech, the fact that Commander Shepard needed assistance to decipher the message is a minor footnote compared to the Prothean's accomplishment, getting any of the message to Shepard at all. Okay, I'm gonna actually, believe it or not, at this point, I can save. I'm gonna call it an episode at this point, and next episode we will begin the mission in earnest. No updates to journal. So thanks for watching. Endure. In enduring, grow strong.